First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to talk at this conference. The topic I'm talking about is not quite new. It's a paper from 2 years ago, which we call reductive group actions. It's in the archive, 2015, and but the other topic which I would have talked about, I talked in Levico, and there is a non-trivial intersection with the audience in Levico and here, so I chose this topic, which is also a little bit more fundamental. So the title Reductive Group Actions is actually a takeoff from a very famous paper called Group Reductiv by Borel and Tips. And the gist is that we at least started to do for group actions the same thing which they did for algebraic groups, namely to develop a theory which is valid over an arbitrary field. So far we are stuck with fields of characteristic zero and positive characteristics. They are really very fundamental obstacles. Therefore, I'm not very confident that we can push that through in positive characteristic. Even over perfect fields, I think it's a little bit difficult, and over non-perfect fields, I think it would be impossible. Okay, the setup is here. So I was told last time I gave this talk 2 weeks ago the talk will contain a lot of notation, to write the notation here, develop the notation also on the blackboard. So it's with me on the left-hand side. So little k is going to be always a field of characteristic zero, and it's completely valid to think about k as a field of real numbers. That's what the theory is actually was first designed for. Then capital K is the algebraic closure, so capital K could be then the complex numbers. G is going to be a connected reductive group over little k, and it's important to think about G, but a non-split group. Over split groups, the theory is just the same over capital K and little k. So X is going to be a G variety, and the main gist of or aim of this work is to study K rational points. So we assume that there are enough of them, so we assume that the K rational points on X are dense. We call that K dense, but it seems nobody has invented a name for it yet. Again, the most important case is where X is in of the form G mod H, where H is a closed subgroup defined over little k. So it's homogeneous. So the goal is to understand the geometry of the k-rational points. And here I'm thinking of flats, Hausdorff spheres, spheres, and so on. Some of these guys you can actually define in this generality. Then one would like also to parametrize X of K, something like Iwasawa decomposition, polar decompositions, and also the G of K orbits in there, and so on. But the main point was for us, by the way, this whole thing is this was joint work with Bernhard Kreutz, and for him K should be R, and the ultimate goal is to find the Plancherel theorem for for the g of k action on L2 functions on x of k, where k is ideally at the end a local field. And what I want to talk about in more detail today is how to compactify the set of k rational points, and to say also what it actually means that to compactify this set. Okay, then we will see soon that complete results are only to be expected for so-called k spherical varieties. We will say later on what they are. And here we want to, for those, we want to construct very explicit embeddings x into x bar, such that the number of g orbits is finite. By the way, I'm using this old language used by Borel and Titz, that who basically confuse x with its set of capital K rational points. So, if I say g orbits is finite, I mean this set of g of capital K orbits is finite. Okay, then each g orbit contains a k rational point. Then, and now comes my substitute for compactness in this generality. Whenever I have a bigger embedding, then I do not gain any more k rational points. But I would like to stress that this embedding x bar is not complete as a variety. I will make an example later on where we will see why this is so. So, and we will also have a very good control over this embedding by exhibiting an explicit open chart which is meeting every G orbit. It's a so-called local structure theorem. And finally, X bar is smooth for many X, and then we actually have constructed a wonderful embedding. So the philosophy behind the whole thing is that we will treat unisotropic groups as a black box. I mean, if you look already at the third item here, then k is the real numbers, then unisotropic groups are just compact groups. Well, and homogeneous varieties for compact groups are again compact. So they don't have to be compactified anymore. So there is nothing to say for compact groups, and there will be nothing to say for anisotropic groups. So this is the black box, which is also present in Borel-Titz theory of algebraic groups. And in fact, the case where X is equal to G with G cross G action is of course a special case of our setup. Even though for this special case, Borel-Titz results are much more complete than ours. So let me say first something about how the theory works over the algebraic closure. You all know that variety is called spherical if Borel subgroup has a dense open orbit. So let me, so B and G is a Borel subgroup. And you all know examples, namely all toroid are spherical, all symmetric varieties are spherical, all partial flat varieties are spherical. And then there are some affine homogeneous ones which are do not fit into this pattern, like these two series, but actually the most spherical varieties have a non-reductive isotropic group. Even though representation theoretics, they are not that important. Now these guys have been now classified, first by Luna, case A, then Lusev showed that how to characterize spherical varieties by certain data, and Bravi and Pizzini finally showed that that for each of these combinatorial data there actually exists a spherical variety. So this is now pretty well understood. And now let me give you the definition what is a wonderful compactification. And here we mean that the boundary is a normal crossing divisors, and the set of components of this crossing divisor is called delta. And now for each subset I of delta, I take the intersection of the corresponding components and call this x sub I bar. And the wonderfulness now means also that the x sub I bar are exactly the orbit closures. That means in particular that these intersections are all irreducible, smooth anyway by normal crossing divisor, and contain a dense orbit, open dense orbit. In particular, there are that many orbits of codimension S. And Luna has shown that only spherical varieties have a chance to have a wonderful embedding. Now, the term wonderful was coined in a paper by De Concini and Cochesi, who actually showed that all symmetric varieties for adjoint, where G is of adjoint type, have wonderful embeddings. And this theorem was later generalized by Lyon, and also partially by last step by me. And the condition that G is of adjoint type has to be replaced by the condition that H is self-normalizing. That's exactly what adjointness does in the case of symmetric varieties. And in this case, X has a wonderful embedding. So Guillaume showed that the embedding is what is called a smooth orbit fold. And then later on, the last step also showed that it's actually smooth. So now I give you a classical example and show you how not to generalize the algebraic closed theory to the non-closed fields. Namely, the example of conics. And the classical embedding X into P5 is not wonderful. Yeah, this is just given by saying that a quadratic form has six coefficients, so which have no relation, so X could be embedded into a P5, but it has three orbits which are of codimension 0, 1, and 3. Instead, one takes the variety of complete quadratics, where one takes the diagonal embedding of X into P5 and its dual, and takes the closure there. And then actually we have four orbits, two of codimension 1 and one of codimension 2. So, now you could think, well, if I have a split real form of this guy, I just take the closure of the real points. That is the easiest to do. So we take now actually a quasi-split real form, namely G will be the unitary group, projected unitary group PU21 and H PO21. And then one checks easily that complex conjugation swaps the two divisors, D1 and D2. It means in particular, they do not contain any real points in its interior. And so, if I take the closure or the real points of my complete quadrics, well, these decompose only in two orbits. That's not so bad, but one orbit is just this G mod B, and it has codimension 2. So that's not what you want to do. You want to, in a wonderful embedding, you want a boundary which is of codimension 1. So what you're actually doing is you blow up this, so you have this two divisors. What you're doing is you blow up, here's the closed orbit, this orbit, then you get something like this. And then you remove these two divisors here. And in this case, actually, the real points look kind of transversal to this component, to the exceptional divisor, and you actually get something which is of co-dimension 1 in the boundary. So here I would like to notice that in their book on compactifications of symmetric varieties exactly fell into this trap. So they define exactly the wonderful embedding of a real form of a symmetric space by taking the real points of the wonderful embedding over C. And then they prove something, or claim to prove something about it. But it's kind of funny because they prove something, the results are all true for the true wonderful embedding, which I'm explaining you in a minute, but not for the wonderful embedding which they have produced. So this is actually a second mistake in their book, which is independent of the one which Timashov already pointed out. Okay, so how to do it correctly? For that we take a minimal parabolic subgroup that is going to be the replacement for the Borel subgroup. That's common knowledge. Actually, the Borel subgroup has two analogues over an arbitrary field, namely if I take the Langlands decomposition P equals 8AN, where N is anisotropic, and anisotropic I mean it does not contain any subgroup of the form GA or split GM, and A is the maximal split torus of G, and N is unipotent normal subgroups, the unipotent radical of P, and then actually there is a second analog of B, namely A times N, where I omit the M part, and that is the maximal split solvable subgroup. And kind of the difficulty in this game was always to find which, if there is something with B in the algebraic closed theory, which analog to take each time. And for example, in the Wienberg-Kimmelfeld statement, there is a statement about highest weight vectors, and there actually it's much better to take AN highest weight vectors in K of X because it's easy to see that they exist, yeah, because it's a split solvable group. Then psi K of X is the set of characters of highest weights which you actually get. This is a group. I mean, I'm taking here rational functions. And AK of X is exactly the split torus which has psi K of X as a character group. Okay? And NK of X is going to be the dual of the rational dual of psi K of X. And all these three objects beforehand, they have rank respectively a dimension, they are all the same, and this is called the rank of X. And observe that the psi k of x is a subgroup of psi of a. A is the maximal split torus. Therefore, conversely, a sub k of x is a quotient of a. Okay, now what I'm going to do is I'm taking our quotients of x by two subgroups, namely, first of all, quotient by An, and I call this the anisotropic kernel of X. Of course, this quotient exists only on an open subset of X. And on the other hand, if I only divide out n, then I get what you call the elementary kernel of x, and they are closely related. First of all, the field of rational functions on the anisotropic, respectively, the elementary kernel are just these invariant rational functions on x, and therefore, on a birational point of view, these two varieties, xan and xel, are unique. Then there are also residual actions, namely of m, respectively ma, on xan and xel. And actually, there is clearly always a projection from xel to xan, which makes xel a principal bundle over the anisotropic kernel with fiber ak of x. So the real important thing or unknown thing is this here, well, of course, principal bundles for spintros, this is basically a theory of line bundles, which you have to know. They are easy to manage. Okay, now the most important cases where this residual action of m on xan is actually transitive. And this means that p, if I take also the quotient now by m, then I get just a point. But that means exactly that p has a dense open orbit in x. So a variety is called k-spherical if the minimal parabolic has a dense open orbit. Examples for k-spherical varieties come from k-forms of spherical varieties, because if B has a dense open orbit, then P will have a dense open orbit as well. So that's what I already said. X is k-spherical if and only if M acts transitively on xan. So this is a certain homogeneous space for an anisotropic group. And every absolutely spherical variety is little k-spherical, but and if G is anisotropic, then actually every homogeneous space is k-spherical. And by now we have generalized the classification of Krämer and Brion and Mikityuk on case R spherical varieties where the isotropic group is reductive. It was a lot of work, and it turned out that actually most R spherical varieties are already absolutely spherical, but there are exceptions. And here is an example of a k-spherical variety which is not absolutely spherical over a field which is not R. Namely, you take the homogeneous space GL2D module GL2E, where D is any finite dimensional division algebra, and E is a subalgebra of index 3. So, now I would like to... The embeddings of over the algebraic closure are being classified by the valuation cone, and now I give you the K analog of the valuation cone. Now every smooth embedding X into X bar with the boundary is just an irreducible divisor is yields a G invariant valuation of the function field here. And now in the spherical case, absolutely spherical case, one just classifies all G invariant valuations, but it, in the non-spherical case, it has been already known that there are just way too many. But there is a particular subclass of them, namely those which are trivial on the B invariants, B invariant rational functions. And that is what we now generalize as well. Namely, I take now all valuations which are trivial on the field of rational functions of the anisotropic kernel. As I told you, the anisotropic kernel is, this makes sense because the anisotropic kernel is treated as a black box. So our evaluation should be trivial there. And then, actually, again, it is true that the set ZK of X of these so-called central evaluations, they form a finitely generated solid convex cone in this finite dimension Q vector space N sub K of X, which calls the evaluation cone. a fan on in N sub K of X is well known, giving rise to a toroidal embedding of this split torus A sub K, which I call A sub K of F. And starting from this embedding, I can also get now an embedding of the elementary kernel. The anisotropic kernel doesn't have to be compactified anymore, but the elementary kernel can be compactified because it is a bundle over XAN where the fibers are AK, and now I just compactify this fiber-wise.
So this fan, this fan should sit in the central
volume. Not yet. In a moment. And so far, this fan gives you an embedding of XEL and fiber-wise. So this is just this fiber product. And now the thing is, as Dima already pointed out, not all of these embeddings extend to an embedding of X. You need some extra condition, and this extra condition is that this fan is supported on the evaluation cone. For that, for the next statement, I also need the so-called adaptive parabolic subgroup. So this is, in the k-spherical case, just a stabilizer of the open p-orbit. Contains p, therefore it is defined over k, so it's a parabolic defined over k. And now, the theorem is, let k be k-spherical for simplicity, with adaptive parabolic, and the leading part is L, and U is the unipotent radical of this adaptive parabolic. And let F now be a fan which is supported in the evaluation cone. Then one can find an embedding of X into X of F with the property that there is a Q in equivariant, there should be a Q invariant open chart. And this open chart is, has the structure of a fiber bundle QK cos L over this partially compacted element, elementary kernel. So please note that QK cos L XEL of F, you can also simply say is the same as the product of U with XEL. So this open chart actually is extremely well to control. So, and to make the whole statement non-trivial, one has also has to stipulate that A times M orbits in here correspond exactly to the G orbits in X of M. Okay. Now the main point of the main non-trivial point is actually the its local structure here, and for that you somehow have to get the elementary kernel into X. Yeah? Remember that we have X0 inside X, and it's mapping to XEL, mapping to XAN. And what the theorem says in particular, that you can split this, that there's a splitting of this projection, which makes then this here a trivial fiber bundle with fiber N. Okay, and for that one has to prove a local structure theorem. I remind you that the first local structure theorem was proved by Brion Bonabus, and I have been proving versions of the local structure theorem ever since. I think this is version number 6 or 7, this is now the one which works over over an arbitrary field of characteristic zero. Namely, it's a relative version now, namely relative to a subvariety, because we want to study the boundary of x. Y is going to be in the boundary. So x is just a normal g variety, y is some g stable subvariety, and I assume it's y is k dense, has enough. X is, can be arbitrary. Then let q be the adapted parabolic of y, and then there is an L-stable affine subvariety of x with the property that again this fiber bundle is this q cross LZ is an open subset of x. Again, at that point you could still say Z is the empty set, but this will not be the case anymore with the next statement, namely the intersection of Z with Y is non-empty. All L orbits are closed in the intersection, and all unipotent elements of L of K act trivially on this intersection. Mind you, the original version over of the local structure theorem over an algebraically closed field stipulates that the derived subgroup of L acts trivially on the intersection. So you have killed the derived subgroup. That you cannot do anymore. You cannot kill actions of anisotropic groups, but basically it says only on Z intersected Y, basically only the maximal split torus is still acting at most, and all anisotropic factors of L. This theorem is not even trivial if Y is equal to X, because then it intuitively tells you that this projection here has a section. So the idea of the proof is the following. It's again adapted from the algebraic closed proof. One starts with a Q semi-invariant function which is non-trivial on Y. Let's say we have that. And then we get a morphism from X0, which is a non-zero set of F, to the dual of the Lie algebra, somehow related to the Roman map. Namely, you take just the derivative of F with respect to some element of the Lie algebra, divided by F, and get, you get a rational function, and this gives you a map from X0 to the dual of the Lie algebra. Then you show that the image of X0 actually is contained in the affine subspace, which is parallel to the annihilator of the Lie algebra of Q. So you would plus, you shift it, translated by the character of F. And then under some non-degeneracy condition, which is usually, yeah, which has to be met, then actually this is just a single Q orbit. And it's of the form Q mod L. And this means now you have produced a map from X0 to Q mod L, but this is equivalent to that the fiber is going to be the slice, and this is equivalent that X0 is a fiber product. Okay, hence X0 is a fiber product. The problem is now to find an F which is defined over the over little k. And yeah, one should also say here is where characteristic k equals 0 enters because of this derivative business. And the problem is we need enough p semi invariants at least. I mean, q semi invariant will be in particular p semi invariant, which are defined over k. And as I said, because a times n is a split solvable group, that has a lot of semi-invariants, but we really want to have this semi-invariants now being m-invariant. Yeah? To make them m-invariant, but now it uses, and that's main ingredient in the whole theory, the theorem of Kent, which says that if an anisotropic group acts on an affine variety, then each k rational points is contained in a closed M orbit. That's a corollary of his theory of optimal one-parameter groups. Okay, and if that is, if certain orbits are closed, then this means they are invariant. Okay, now after this, I would like to exhibit a little bit the properties of this embedding X of F. And we call a variety, this is now not a very good concept, but it works in our case, namely a normal G variety I call K complete if any bigger embedding, embedding does not produce any more K rational points. Normality is really important here because otherwise you just take an orbit of the Galois group points and then you glue them. And then you get automatically a k-rational point for which was not there beforehand. Okay, and now the theorem is that this is actually no longer not that difficult anymore. The embedding X of F is k-complete if the support of this fan actually is the valuation problem. That's just the same thing as over capital K. And this means, for example, that if little k is a local field, so periodic or R or C, then actually the k rational points of X of F, they are a real compactification, I mean an honest compactification of X of K in the Hausdorff topology. In particular, with this local structure theorem, one can show that X of K actually is dense in not only open, but also dense in this set of k-rational points. Okay. That brings us to the question, the easiest case would actually be if zk would be a pointed, strictly convex cone, because then it has a canonical fan supported on it, namely just the cone itself. And when is that? That is actually if and only if, now in the capital K case, this would be if H is finite in its normalizer, the analog, correct analog over little k is now it's the quotient of the normalizer by H is anisotropic. So the automorphism group of X should be an anisotropic. And in this case, one can define what I call the standard embedding, which is just taking for F equal to Z. It's exactly one closed orbit. So, now I would like to introduce this the basic structure theorem of this Z. Because a priori Z could be anything, any finitely generated cone, but over C it was proved by Brion that it's actually a simplicial cone always, and the analog also holds. So let me set up some notation here for I'm choosing a scalar product which is W invariant, and then you can actually talk about reflections on N sub K of X. This is just an intermediate an auxiliary structure. And the theorem is now again, Brion's result theorem holds, evaluation cone is the fundamental domain for finite reflection group acting on N sub K of X. So it's a Weyl chamber. And this means that the standard embedding is always a smooth orbifold, because the corresponding torus embedding is one. And now, if additionally, it follows now, if additionally the standard embedding happens to be smooth, then it was, would actually be a wonderful embedding in the sense of what I have defined beforehand. And one can show its methods, which I also developed in overseas, that there's always a diagonalizable group E. If you divide this out, then the quotient does admit a K. K wonderful embedding, and in particular, for example, if the H is self-normalizing in G, then E would be automatically trivial, and then X would have a wonderful embedding. So now let's introduce roots. The simple roots are just the linear forms on nk of x, which define the two-dimensional one faces of the Weyl chamber Z, and they are here normalized such that they are primitive, and these guys are k spherical, and by Brion's theorem, or the k analog of it, they are also linearly independent. So sigma k of x is a set of k spherical roots, and they form, it's another way to phrase it, as the simple roots of a root system, this Weyl group W k of x. And now the criterion is that the standard embedding is smooth if and only if actually the psi k of x is the root lattice of this root system. Now, now comes the second part, namely also Borel and Titz have a long section on comparing the theory of a reductive group over K with the theory over the algebraic closure. And the same thing works also in this generality. And here it came in actually handy that I had already developed a theory of spherical roots and valuation cones over arbitrary G varieties over in the algebraic closed case, which are not spherical. Because, as I said, a little k spherical variety does not have to be absolutely spherical. So you get actually something of higher complexity if you go to the algebraic closure. But still, this psi k is now, you just take the character group over the algebraic closure and restrict it to A, and then psi k, it's almost by definition. Then AK is just the, A little k is just the image of the maximum split group in A capital K. And NK is holds the same thing. And but now comes a major theorem, namely that the little valuation cone is just the intersection of the big valuation cone with this subspace N sub K. So for complete quadrics, the case which I've shown you is the valuation cone over C looks like this, and N sub R is just this line here. Okay? So our Z sub R is just this half line. And what you should take as a compactification is now the fan consisting of this half line and not the fan coming from this cone. So that's why things go wrong. Now, WK also can be, little k can be recovered from as a restricted reflection group from WK. And sigma k, now we have some difficulties with normalizations, but the little k spherical roots are basically the restrictions of the capital K spherical roots to A. And let me give you an example Which one do you actually have? 4.04. Let me give you two examples now what can happen. In both cases, K is going to be R. And now X is the group E72. This is just the second E7 list, second E7 form in the list, the Cartan's list. So probably it's something like E Roman 5 or something like that. And anyway, I give you the Zatake-Titz diagram of this real form E72. That is, so the minimal parabolic has an anisotropic kernel which is 3 times A1, of type 3 times A1. And the lunar diagram of the complexification of this homogeneous space is looking like this. If you are unused to this notation, it means the following. These are this solid dot here means that the sigma, one of the sigmas is 2 times this simple root plus 2 times this, 2 times this, 1 times this. So there are 2 of these types. And the underlined dot means that I have 2 times a simple root. Anyway, these are 3 linear combinations of simple roots, and these are the spherical roots of over C. Now, how do you get the adapted parabolic? The adapted parabolic should be defined over R. That means it should contain all the non-circled items in the Zatake-Titz diagram, but it also should contain all items which are which have no in the lunar diagram which have no circle attached to it. So we get qk of x is a little bit bigger than p of the minimal parabolic, and so the elementary kernel is actually this guy, and as I say, the this guy here actually has a an isotropic component, namely spin 6-2, and this acts trivially on the elementary. So it really shows that the kernel is this action is divided up. And now the if I take the restricted roots, then there are 4 of them. They form an F4 diagram. And these, there are 2 spherical roots now, which restrict to something non-zero. And one of them is 2 times this, 2 times this, 1 times this. And the other one is 2, 2, 2. And this is, I chose this example to show you that actually this diagram here is not the lunar diagram of anything, because this 2, 2, 1 is not a spherical root in over C. So this is not the lunar diagram of any variety, so you actually get combinatorics which is more general than over the complex numbers. The second example is going to be SP42 for H, where H is now a non-reductive subgroup, namely SP42 contains SP20 cross SP22, and SP22 is the rank 1 form, so it has a minimal parabolic, and that is, so H is going to be SP20 cross the minimal parabolic of the SP22 factor. And then the Zatake-Titz diagram of SP42 is this here, so it's rank 1. The lunar diagram looks like this, where this here means this is just a sum. This spherical root is just a sum of these 2 simple roots, and this guy here means that the second spherical root is just the second simple root. And this forms a diagram of type G2. And you see that actually this spherical root here is supported only here in the anisotropic part of G. So you could make a some kind of a Satake-Titz diagram out of this. And again, this Satake-Titz diagram does not exist. So there is no G2 form which has this. All G2 forms are either compact or split. So this is not the Satake-Titz diagram of any group. And moreover, if I take now the restricted root system, that is the G2, and restrict it now to such that sigma 1, that guy is becoming 0, yeah, then you get the little restricted root system for over R. And you see that, well, if you take the entire root system, you do not, the restriction is not either root system. So this shows that the root system itself has, is not really very important, has no real significance. It's just the simple roots which have this, any geometric significance. I should stop now, I guess. But
I'm still interested.
Yeah. Do I get special permission? No, this slide here shows you there's actually a K analog of a flag variety. Namely, these are the rank 0 varieties, and they're interesting because exactly the closed object in the wonderful embedding or the standard embedding has rank 0. And one can show that every generalized flag variety has rank 0, the homogeneous variety of an anisotropic group has rank 0, and the general case is just a combination, that means it's induced. Any rank 0 variety is induced from an anisotropic action. Okay, so there is a complete classification. The next case is where if you want to see which varieties actually have a valuation code which is as big as possible, these are called K-Hoare spherical. And let me give you just the last sentence. So every K-Hoare spherical variety is just an AK bundle over a rank 0 variety. Okay, that's. And now, if you take the wonderful embedding, then the orbits in the wonderful embedding are parametrized by subsets of spherical roots. And we have seen it already in a talk yesterday that. One can take the normal bundle of one of these orbits in the and show that the normal bundle always contains again an open group. These are called the boundary degenerations of X, and the particular boundary degeneration is the one which is coming from the closed orbit. This is called the space of Hoare spheres for X. But the boundary degenerations are kind of intermediate Hoare sphere spaces. And the importance of this is that somehow these boundary degenerations should show you different parts of the tempered spectrum of X. That means at the end of the day we want to have a Clausewitz theorem. And we now can show in many cases that the tempered spectrum of X of X is basically coming from the discrete series of the boundary degeneration. So everything is kind of reduced again to the discrete spectrum. And in a split case, a p-adic case, this has been proved by Sakilaridis and Venkatesh. That was actually our blueprint, and we have proved it together with Schlichtkohl in the Archimedean case when X is absolutely spherical or the waveform. This is a certain technical condition which we have.